So, hello everybody. My name is Angelo, and I work as an embedded systems engineer at TimeSys Corporation. So, I thought to speak about early boot stages. I know these are probably quite well-known arguments that you often find in such kind of talks, but I thought it may be interesting to talk again about this, because sometimes when you are over the Linux boot, you are more familiar, but sometimes the early boot stages may be more complex. So these are some abbreviations I will use. So this is the roadmap I will try to keep. And it ranges from generic boot concepts through ROM bootloader, and of course reaching also touching U-boot, and touching some hardware troubleshooting and things like that. So of course I am focusing on system on chips. There are the majority of the chips used nowadays. So of course they generally offer multiple boot options, because they are full of hardware modules and interfaces built in inside. So here comes into play the ROM bootloader, so the read-only memory bootloader. That is, of course, a program that is generally not updatable. And it makes the initial initializations and decisions about from what device to boot. So just after, it comes into play the static RAM, so where to boot the code, of course. This system on chips has inside a static random access memory that is mainly, it is mainly a kind of memory that you will know probably already, that doesn't require any refresh cycles, so it's easy to be assessed and used. It's quite fast and so on. So you have generally two chances of execution that are execution in place and execution of code that has been already copied into static RAM. So when you have a program that needs to be serially read, generally you have an header with a lot of information inside, and also, of course, the size to read from the ROM bootloader. In some cases, ROM bootloader may miss, so there may be maybe legacy or old CPUs that are booting directly from a parallel bus, like maybe Coalfire stuff or things like that. So it also runs Linux, but of course the boot is more simple. Otherwise, okay, execution in place requires random access. Of course you have the code that is loaded, and in the code there may be of course jumps. So the ability to read from a certain specific address is needed. So then there are some definitions, as a ROM bootloader is generally the first program loader. And then there are secondary program loader that is the first binary read and the next to be executed. Then you find SPL. You may find a tertiary program loader in some specific cases that we will see later. So as a Linux-oriented boot, we are landing on, of course, 32-bit CPUs or major, of course, or 64. So are those supported from Linux. So you generally need on board some synchronous dynamic random access memory, so DDR or older SDRAM. And because, of course, you need an appropriate amount of RAM to run the kernel, so maybe 10 megabytes, 16 megabytes, something like that. So then, of course, a non-volatile memory is needed, and to boot, to read, of course, the root file system and all the rest. And an SD card or USB stick may be useful, of course, for development to test the kernel multiple times and be able to have a fast development. So U-boot is a common choice. Of course, you have several bootloaders, several choices. It's not that hard to program a proper bootloader in case, but of course, U-boot offers a lot of help, and many of you will know it already. So you can do a lot of things so from U-boot. And at the end, it is good because it's popular. There is a friendly community, and there are regular releases. So in case you have issues with U-boot, it's always better to try a recent mainline code or the last stable release. So these are some extremes. So we can go from a simple boot with just a single binary, uncompressed code, and standalone, to, of course, at the more recent TrustZone secure world boot, where you have a lot of blobs involved. And so these are kind of extremes I tried to figure out. A bootloader may be avoided, of course, but this is unusual and not often such flexible, let's say. Okay, this is a common generic boot from this is about normal world and 32-bit systems. And you see that in the first stages, there is always this ROM bootloader after reset that starts to check and evaluate some conditions. So one condition is initially this bootstrap pins. So you have generally resistors on the board, or you can have some switches that defines this bootstrap code. So the system on chip knows, for example, what is the device selected for the boot. Of course, you may have also fuses that you flash, like one-time programming fuses. So generally, the ROM bootloader checks also those fuses. And finally, the ROM bootloader needs to read the first program from the selected boot device. And of course, it reads it inside a built-in static RAM, on-chip RAM. And that may be from small size, like 4 kilobyte, to sometime also 500 and 12 kilobyte. It depends from the system on chip, of course. You have a lot of scenarios. And then once the first program has been loaded, of course, you need to initialize, and if you want to try in the DDR, and then you finally can load Linux into DDR and jump to it. So this is just a route schematic. So these are something about bootstrap pins. It's very, very simple. So you have generally resistors. As you can see from the image, there are generally three pads, so you can unsolder and move it eventually. Or there may be switches. Of course, the CPU samples these pins at first reset, but just after you can use the pin for other purposes, like GPIOs or the like. So we can boot from different memory types. This starts to be interesting. So system architect should define the proper hardware. So depending if it's needed a fast boot or keeping the cost low. Okay, this is one of the common boot device, is SPiNOR flash. You will probably, many of you will know it already. I am talking about the standard SPI, so it's a bit simpler. And of course, for this kind of memory that is often used for U-boot or initial boot, you have four wires, so it's very simple, the connection. You have master input, slave output, that needs to be connected to master input, slave output. So it's difficult to make mistake, but still, of course, you can find swapped wires on prototypes, because sometimes the constructor of the chip is using a different naming. So he's using DO, DE for the bidirectional lines, and sometimes maybe swapped. But so here you have a clock, and it's quite easy to troubleshoot, to debug. So you can check the clock by oscilloscope if it's, something is red. And of course, there is a chip select that is a signal that you keep low to select the chip, and then you can start the conversation, let's say. So this is a quite common option, this SPiNOR. So it's used to isolate your boot generally, and it is synchronous. Of course, it is full duplex, but for the first boot, of course, it is generally used just reading. It's simple to wire, and of course, these SOIC packages are simple to unsolder in case you have some issue in place of reprogramming through JTAG or something else. So transfer rate is, of course, clock dependent, and of course, it's dependent from the lines, from the data lines, of course. So this chip is not random access, but when you go to over quad and octal, there are a lot of chips that are execution in place enabled. So you can read bursts of bytes, group of bytes, using, of course, specific commands that are available in quad and octal bus devices. Okay, this is an old new friend. Is the parallel NOR. So, who worked with old CPUs will probably know this very well. So you have just an address bus and a data bus and some signals to read and to write and to select the chip, of course. So it's interesting to see that this is a 16-bit words chip that are very common. And the CPU side address 1 is wired to the address 0 because, of course, at each address increment, you have to read 16 words, so not a single byte. So for this reason, the A1 is mapped to A0. So still on parallel NOR, they are often used for execution in place. So the code is very simply read from the CPU and executed immediately. So it's just a fetch and execute way, as in the old CPU, as for example 8051 or the like. So where they were reading from EEPROM or flash chips. And the read operation is quite simple. So these chips are, of course, random access because you can set on the address bus the exact address that you want to read. So you can jump over the code. And the read procedure, for example, is very simple. So you have to put down the chip select, put down the output enable, and then at this point, of course, you have to configure the wait states on the CPU because these kind of chips are giving the output after a certain time. So if you read before, you can find simply garbage. And once the CPU has waited the proper time, you can find the data in the database. But the throughput in this simple way of reading is not very impressive. So this kind of NOR parallel chips are used generally in another way for fast boot. So you need to configure page mode and also set as cacheable the address range used from the parallel NOR. So this may be done simply setting some bits on proper registers generally. So you set the address on the address lines, chip select and output enable are set low. So you have a first read delay, but then you still keep chip select and output enable low, and you can increment the address. So the next word is available much sooner, so in 10 nanoseconds, for example. And the speed is much better. It's near 100 megabytes per second. So this is a NAND flash memory, non-volatile memory, of course, and it's quite different from the other memories we have seen. So that there is a kind of database, but it's bidirectional, and also there are two wires. So you can see CLE and ALE that are used to combine commands for the NAND. And so the NAND flash is more error prone, is much faster, of course, writing compared to the NOR parallel flash, and is quite fast for reading. But of course, since it is an error prone technology, you need a mechanism, so error correction mechanism done by software. Then is a very interesting chip. It's very nice to use. It's the eMMC that is mainly like an SD card, but of course is in the shape of in the package of a chip. And the protocol is very similar. It's very similar to SDIO, more or less. So you have a clock, a command line, and a database that is often eight lines, and it often works also with the DDR, so can reach very high speed, like 400 megabytes per second. But of course, this kind of chips requires an initialization time, because they have inside a circuit that manages the NAND flash that is inside, and take care, of course, of everything, of error correction and everything. So you just see this chip as an SD card. You can partition and use it in a very friendly way. But of course, still requires 50 milliseconds about before you are able to read data. It is not random access, so you need, of course, to read block by block and shadow the code on the static RAM. These are some other, this is SD card, of course, maybe used for development. There are often some quite high time, because before you can read the data from it. These are some other technologies I have inspected that are available for as a non-volatile boot methods. There may be other, of course, but I couldn't enter for a matter of time also and of knowledge. So this is these are some typical cases of boot. So you generally have a ROM bootloader, of course, and if you are able in a non-secure world to you can boot U-boot, you are able to make it fit inside the static RAM, so in very big static RAM chips. So you can then easily initialize SDRAM, DDR, and boot Linux. While where you cannot make U-boot fit inside the static RAM, at this point you generally use another mechanism that is a secondary program loader, and that is smaller and can fit inside the static RAM, and it generally then initializes DDR and loads, if you want, the full U-boot and then the kernel. But it's more common. You can find that SPL can boot directly the Linux kernel. There is a FICOM mode. Sorry for the error. So this FICOM mode mainly allows to initialize and directly boot the kernel without passing for the full reboot. You can still exit from SPL, generally type in a key, and load the normal U-boot, so you have the command access and you can manage some operation from there. And of course, this exit pressing a key needs to be implemented in the board C file. This is a case where you may find TPL, of course, so tertiary program loader. There are specific cases where, for example, on one end, you can just read 1 kilobyte, for example. So it's not mainly a static RAM limitation, but it's a limitation of the size of the code. And then, so you can initialize the DDR later from the TPL, boot U-boot, and the kernel. Okay, this is an interesting case. I found working on this ColdFire, quite legacy stuff. But mainly everything is, the static RAM is small, but has been put in the header a small size of code that is read from the ROM bootloader. And inside this small part of the bootloader is performed the DDR initialization. So you need to check the linker script and to put the code in the initial part. And then you are able to, of course, load the rest of the binary through proper simple driver. And it's just a thing I have found, so I just mentioned it. This is IMX, some more IMX scenario. So who worked with IMX chips probably knows this well. So this kind of a system on chips allows you to prepend the boot program with some special operative codes, and so you are able to initialize the DDR, for example, before booting the second program loader. So you can initialize the DDR and boot a new boot bigger than the static RAM size. Of course, you load it directly into DDR. And this method is, by the way, not always welcome, because several times a training is preferred on the DDR, especially for some special cases where you have edge thermal conditions, stuff like that. So a training is always better. So sometimes you find still inside the U-boot code a training done later. Then there is also a chance to boot directly the kernel that I just briefly tested it, but it's not really versatile, of course. Okay, then some words on TrustZone. It's the more actual technology. So now several system on chips already boots from Secure World. So there are specifications, but there are sometimes different implementations are very wide to be covered in this talk. So you may have an additional core that is managing the boot. You have different boot blobs. And also you may find proprietary blobs that there are a lot of guys actually working to try to keep it open. So you will find a lot of information in this two links, so where you can find all the platform supporting this secure world boot. Okay, here are some common U-boot commands. So these are very, very well-known commands generally. So you have a command to check the device tree that is generally built with U-boot. And it's very useful to load the kernel image from the file system. So it's simple. You can just access the file. And you access the, so U-boot is offering, of course, a lot of file system support. Then you have commands for memory display, of course, command for writing fuses. You have this command is nice, it's on IMX. So there are cases where you don't have access to boot mode switches. So you can use this B mode to reboot in a different boot mode. Or if you don't have B mode built in, because it needs to be configured, of course, in your boot, you may use some trick like this directly writing on register. So it's kind of tricky way to reboot in a different mode. So then you have GPIO, of course, commands. So you can test on prototypes. You can enable some circuit stages. You can see if they work before booting Linux, of course. Then here are commands to access the, for example, the SPI NOR flash. And of course, the SPI flash, NOR flash needs to be supported. So you need to define the support for it in U-boot specific board includes. Then I like to use, for example, load Y. It's a command that you can just load the binary through the console. So it's quite old way, but I find it useful because you don't need to care about the network. And then, of course, you can flash directly the SPI NOR. These are most common boot commands. So you have go for an uncompressed kernel, for example. It's kind of legacy command. Then you have the more common boot M that is loading U images. Then you have boot Z that is loading Z images. And then there is the newer FIT image way. So you can load this kind of FIT image built from a device tree and so on. So you can boot through FIT image. Okay, these are some tricks about optimization that I have experienced. So a good result starts often from the hardware. So from the components choice mainly. And most of the cases for a fast boot, the NOR flash, the NOR parallel flash and execution in place is chosen. Of course, you have also, as you have seen, eMMC very fast, but there is a startup time, while the parallel NOR is read immediately after reset. So it's still often chosen as a boot method. Then in your boot, of course, you need to check that the drivers are working in the selected desired mode. So you can enable, for example, DDR for eMMC and stuff like that. So you need to check that everything is really enabled and working. So then you can, of course, disable console and kind of simple tricks. You can check clock signals, of course, on the boot device, so you are sure that you are reading at the proper speed. And of course, you can measure boot time through GPIOs and oscilloscope So you can just put on some pins, some levels, so you can see where you are over the boot. And then there are, of course, kernel optimization. That this is quite complex story. These are some tricks to debug. In case you have a prototype, the first boot is not providing any output, so you can check power supplies. Of course, all the involved chips in the boot needs to have proper power supplies, like 3 and 3 volt and stuff like that, 1.8, that must be stable. And you need to check, of course, the reset signals. Generally, there is a reset circuit, and the signals may reach different multiple chips. So you need to be sure that, of course, one chip is not wrongly resetted before another or things like that. And then, of course, you can check CPU clock sometimes, so it's often possible. You can check activity on the first boot device, so you can check the data lines. So from the SPI NOR, if something is read from the ROM bootloader, you need to see some burst of code. So also from the size, with a good oscilloscope of the data that you see, you can understand in what phase the ROM bootloader is stopping. Of course, often you can find on prototypes and on custom boards errors, even if there are very expensive CAD systems. There should be signal integrity checks and stuff like that, but sometimes you still may find errors. And okay, of course, also here you can add some toggling on the GPIOs. Okay, this is just a small table I did just to show some famous system on chips. I couldn't go over 64-bit stuff because I work just on IMX8, but you can see that quite all of them are offering, for example, execution in place. But not all. So I mean, if you don't have the generic bus, you cannot boot from a parallel NOR, of course. And then you see that newer stuff is has a big static RAM, generally a bigger static RAM. And okay, so that was just a brief comparison. Okay, I completed. Probably quite sooner. So if you have any question, I am happy to try to answer. Thank you very much. Thank you.